I just gotta tell you, I love you guys. Your heart for reaching people is so big. Your heart to stretch out and minister to people here and around the world, it's so big and so awesome. And I can't help but think that Christ is just smiling as he looks down on your heart, your sacrifice, and your service in this regard. Cameron, TJ, would you come up, please? Why don't you get a chance to hear from them as to how their lives have been impacted through this experience. Come on over here if you would. So Cameron, how many years have you gone to Haiti?
This was my second trip.
So how has it impacted you personally in your spiritual walk?
So every year that I go, I'm amazed at the amount of faith people have down in Fort Liberté. You see right away that they don't have a lot of anything, a lot of food or a lot of materials. Their houses are falling apart or about the size, less than the size of the stage for 20 people. But their faith is so strong, and I see that especially with the kids of the King Center. Every year we throw a little party for them, and first they're so grateful for just the little things we can provide, like a Rice Krispie treat, which is so trivial to us, but to them it's like the world. And then they sing for us, and they're always singing praises to God all day long while we're working, and while they're working, they're just doing their laundry, they're just singing praises to God. And that's always so incredible to me, because if I have so much, why is it hard for me to have that kind of faith to God when it's so easy for them when they have so little?
That's great. So TJ, how about you? How many trips have you made?
So this was my fifth trip. It was in 2009. And
So how has it impacted you?
So I'm going to piggyback a little bit with Cameron and, you know, just say every time we're there, you know, they have these huge smiles on their face. And I'm like, the first time I went, I was like, I don't understand, because you don't have much. And, you know, back home, I'm like, we have a lot and I'm not happy either. But, you know, they have so little and so grateful, and their smiles and just their personalities and the way that they carry themselves show that. And, you know, that was a huge eye-opener for me, at least, for my own, you know, my own faith, to say, you know, TJ, you need to be more accepting and more, and, you know, happier with what you have, and, you know, give that to others, you know, show it to others.
That's great. So, TJ, some people may think that we just send you guys on a trip to go work on an orphanage, and they're like, you know, how's that evangelism? But evangelism is done in a lot of different ways, to show the love of Christ, etc. But could you share with the congregation about the church that we connect with and the orphanage itself, so they can understand there's a connection that we're making? Right.
So the church in Fort Liberté that we're connected with is really the center of town, and there's a really strong, strong presence from the church, and it's really the center. Everyone, you know, I would say there's a lot of believers in Fort Liberté. And so why would we send people down to not, if we're not going to evangelize verbally to them? And I think it's simple. It's, you know, we preach here a lot. We all have gifts, and our gifts are spread. You know, there's a lot of people on the team that, you know, Rob Gill runs construction, Les helps run the clinic. We have people that, you know, just interact really well with children. So people using their gifts from this congregation, taking that to the world, is evangelism. And that's just showing the love of God.
That's right. Absolutely. Would you pray with me, please? Father, thank you so much for the work that you're doing in Haiti. Thank you for the privilege we have to team up with our brothers and sisters there to make an impact. Thank you for these children who are going to be impacted through this orphanage to see the love of Christ, to trust you as their personal Savior. Thank you for the willingness that you have given to us to be able to serve others. And we pray that that will continue to expand as we seek to impact people for you in this special, special place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it very much.
Come on. Oh, come to the water. All who are thirsty, come and be filled. Oh, come to the river. Brothers and sisters, come and come on, together. Come to the water, all who are thirsty, come and be filled. Oh, come to the river, brothers and sisters, come and be healed. Come and be healed.
Here we go.
We believe in the kingdom.
There is nothing more powerful than when followers of Jesus listen to Jesus and follow. There is nothing more exhilarating than when people who name the name of Christ listen to Christ's promptings and follow. There is nothing that brings more joy to the Father's heart than when followers of Christ are in tune with his heart and follow. This past week, the Lord put on my heart the name of someone from this congregation that I hadn't connected with since before Christmas. And he really burdened me to make connection with this family. But I didn't have a phone number. Church office was closed due to the storm. I thought, how am I going to reach out to this family? And I remembered that I had connected with them through Facebook. So I left a message. A couple days later, I got a phone call. And the member of the family connected with me, and it was a good thing I did connect with them because there were needs there that had to be met. And then the woman said to me, Pastor, but I want you to know something. Thanks for calling, but there's a couple in this church who have been ministering to us through the crisis we're going through right now. And we feel so much like the arms of Jesus are just surrounding us, because they're stepping up and ministering to us. This past Tuesday night, we had an elders meeting. And in the midst of that elders meeting, we were praying for the church, praying for this ministry, praying for the finances of our ministry, and asking God to work. We finished that meeting, and I went back to my office, and I was picking things up, ready to go home. Knew the storm was coming in, so I thought, you know what? I think I'll go check my mail to see if there's anything in there. So I went to my mailbox and I pulled out an envelope that had come in the mail that day. And I opened it up and there was a letter from a couple in this church who said, we've been blessed by this ministry and God has recently blessed us financially and we want to give back to this ministry so that others can be blessed. And there were two checks in the envelope. Talk about a yay, God. I mean, I was so excited in the midst of it. You see, because there's nothing more invigorating when people who say they follow Jesus listen to Jesus and just follow. Then, last week, a woman filled in a connect card, gave it to Pastor Jeremy after the service. He handed it to me on Tuesday at the staff meeting, and I knew I had to connect with this person because she had some questions. As I looked at the card, I didn't know the person, and I thought, I'm going to hand this off to a woman in our church to connect with her. I was having a meeting that afternoon, and God put on my heart to ask this woman to be the connecting point. She said, sure, be glad to. So she told me she'd call this person. Well, she emailed me during the week. I've left some messages with this person, haven't been able to connect with her. Saturday night, she was on her way to church, to the service, and God put on her heart to call one more time. So she called, left a message. Comes into Saturday night service last night, sitting in church, turned to the person next to her, whom she didn't know, and introduced herself. This person introduced herself to this woman and said, oh, by the way, here's my friend. Guess who the friend was sitting next to her. This woman from our church, this member of our church said, I just left you a phone message about questions that you had, and a connection was made. There's nothing more exciting when Jesus followers listen to Jesus and follow. And today we're going to look at a passage of scripture that speaks just to that. Turn to Matthew 28. Matthew chapter 28, starting in verse 16. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in the seat in front of you, or you can look on the screen. Jesus has now been resurrected. Now we come to the point in verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain that Jesus had directed. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted. Stop there. When I read that this past week, it hit me like a ton of bricks. Christ has been resurrected. He's now taken his disciples to go to this mountain. Scripture says they obeyed him. They followed him. They did what he told them to do. But notice their response. Some worshiped and some doubted. Here's why it hit me. Because there are certain times in my Christian experience that I worship Jesus because I hear what he's telling me. I worship Jesus with my hands lifted up and I'm like, oh, Jesus, yeah, I just love you and I'm so thankful for what you're telling me. But there are other times when I'm not saying, oh, Jesus, I'm saying, are you kidding, Jesus? That I'm filled with doubts. I'm wondering what in the world's going on. It can be in the midst of stress. It can be in the midst of sickness. It can be in the midst of hardship. There are times when I'm worshiping Jesus, but there's other times I'm saying, are you serious? I mean, some of you are out of power a whole week, and you're trying to survive. Some of you had pipes burst, all kinds of stuff going on. And so it's during those times what this scripture encourages me with, these were followers of Jesus. They were obeying Jesus. And some worshiped, but some doubted. And what I love about my Savior is he doesn't pounce on me when I doubt. He says to me, oh, you little faith, let's just come along. Let's just learn another lesson together. And he doesn't upbraid me. He says, all right, let's come together. So some worshiped, some doubted. And Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now that's a lot of authority. First off, notice what the text says, all. In the original language, all means all. And he's saying, all authority has been given to me, not only on earth, but in heaven and on earth. Here's why. Because he has just been raised from the dead and has ascended high above all the heavens itself, the scripture says. He who descended also ascended. And now he's saying, I am Lord. And if I'm the Lord, you're the servant. Now, there's only one responsibility of a servant, to do what the master says. It's not to ask questions. It's not to ask why. It's to do what the master says. So Jesus says, I'm in charge. I'm the Lord, and I'm going to give you a command. Now, in this next verse, there's only one verb. The rest of them are participles. So if you read on, it says this, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. The verb is not go. The verb is not teach. The verb is not baptize. The verb is make disciples. Disciples are followers. And what Jesus is saying to us here is, I'm not looking for fans. I'm looking for followers. I'm looking for people who know I give the orders, and it's up to you to respond to what I tell you to do. And so he says, as you are going, and you are going and doing and making disciples, you're to baptize them, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you. Now, what does he mean when he says make a disciple? See, you cannot be fulfilling this command if you first are not a disciple. You can't make disciples if you're not a disciple. You can't be one following through and saying, I'm going to make disciples if you're going to pick and choose what you're going to obey or not obey that the master tells you to do. You see, he's the master, I'm the servant, and therefore my responsibility is to listen to him and do what he tells me to do. That's why the past 4 weeks when we talked about the new rules of resolution, we said the basic thing is this, follow, follow. He's the one who's in the front. He's the one who's calling the shots. Follow. And as you follow, you will see supernatural things take place. Notice what he says. Lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. Baptizing. The word baptize literally means to immerse, to identify with. So we're spending time today telling you, if you are a follower of Jesus and you have never been baptized, you are not showing that you're a disciple. You can show you're a fan, but you're not showing you're a follower because you're not doing the very first thing Jesus told you to do. See, yeah, but Pastor, you know, I'm not sure I want to get up there and get wet in front of everybody else. Look, he hung on the cross and he was almost naked for you and me. I think you can get wet in front of other people. You see, he says this, you show you're my follower when you do what I tell you to do. And sometimes we don't like what he tells us to do. Sometimes we don't want to hear what he has for us to do. When those promptings come in our heart, when those promptings come to us and he's telling us, you know what he's telling us sometimes? Forgive. Yeah, but Jesus, you don't know what that person did. Yeah, I do. And I paid for it. Forgive. Don't debate. Forgive. Love. Yeah, but Jesus, they're unloving. They're the most unlovable person around. I know. Yeah. So are you most of the time too. And he says, love. Serve. Serve them. Wash their feet. Care for them. You got to be kidding me. Yeah, I wash your stinky feet all the time. I care for you all the time. See, it's a matter we're called to follow. Now, why is this so important? Go over to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. Paul explains this clearly about baptism. And you know what, folks? At any point, God may be speaking to your heart and really urging you to step out and show obedience. Do it. Get up and do it. Listen to him, because there's nothing more exciting than when followers of Jesus listen to Jesus and follow. Romans chapter 6, verse 1. What should we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? And he's talking here about spirit baptism, identifying with the body of Christ, being made a member of the body of Christ. But water baptism shows that we're united with him. When we put our faith and trust in Christ, we were buried with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Anybody who steps forward today, baptism doesn't save. Baptism doesn't save. Baptism is a sign of your salvation. Baptism is a sign of your change of life. Just like the wedding ring. The wedding ring is a symbol to show that I'm married, that I'm committed to my wife, that I have a heart united with my wife's heart. It's an outward sign. When you get baptized, you don't get saved. You're showing people you are saved. You're showing people you are a follower. You're showing people that you are being an obedient follower. That's what baptism's about. Now, there's a beautiful illustration of this found in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, which I love the book of Acts because it talks about the early church and how the early church worked and how the Holy Spirit worked in the midst of the early church. Acts chapter 8. In Acts chapter 8, we have a man named Philip. And Philip is a follower of Christ, and the Spirit begins to speak to Philip. And the Spirit speaks to Philip and tells him to go down this road to a desert place. How often do you find Jesus speaks to you when you're in the desert place? It's when you're in the desert place that he begins to speak to you and the Spirit comes to you. And it says here, he said, go to the desert place. And so he got up and he went. I love it. Spirit speaks, he gets up and he goes. And he goes and he finds this leader of an Ethiopian queen, and he is there and he's reading scripture, and he's in his chariot. And the Spirit speaks to Philip, and he tells Philip, go over and talk to that man. And when you see what he's reading from the book of Isaiah. And listen to what he's reading. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter. And like a lamb before his shearers is silent. So he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generations? And this ruler of the queen turns to Philip and says, let me ask you a question, starting in verse 34. About whom, I ask you, does this prophet say it, about himself or someone else? And Philip opened his mouth and began with this scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. See, that's the gospel, the good news, that we're sinners, but our sins have separated us from God, but God loved us so much that Christ came and gave his life for us so we could be set free. He hung on that cross, was buried, and came back to life. And Philip shares the good news. Now watch. And they were going along the road, and Philip's explaining all this to this Ethiopian ruler. And they came to some water. And the eunuch said, see, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? Now wait a minute. He's in a desert. Remember, that's what the text says. He's in a desert. And in the midst of that desert, he turns and says, there's water, not a puddle. Look, read what the text says. And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water. And Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. You see, we find here is a beautiful picture of baptism. You go into the water to show your identification with Christ. You come up out of the water rejoicing. Not because you're saved by getting in, but because you were saved before you got in. But by getting in, you're showing everybody you're a follower of Christ. Here's my question for you. What about you? What about you? If you say you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior and you've never been baptized, what's up? What's going on? Here's the water. We got the clothes. We got the people. We're ready to go. It's up to you to step up to the plate and stop talking like a fan and start living like a follower. It's up to you to start listening to what Jesus is telling you and taking the next step. And I encourage you to do it today. The rest of you, you've been baptized. You're following Jesus. But what's he saying to you today? What's he whispering to you today? Are you willing to follow? See, there is nothing more exhilarating than when a follower of Christ listens to Jesus and follows Jesus. You know, when I see pictures of Haiti, and I see pictures of teenagers who gave up their Christmas break to go to Haiti, Jesus says, well done. When I see pictures of an orphanage that are being built because you all sacrificed financially to get the materials to get that thing done, you know what Jesus says? Well done. I don't know what Jesus is telling you. I don't know what he's speaking to you. This past week, I had to make a trip to New York because my father was put back in the hospital. He's got pneumonia in both lungs and is really weak. But in the midst of being there, we also discovered his sister now has cancer in her pancreas, her stomach, and her intestines. And I'm sitting there saying, okay, Jesus, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to respond to all of this? And here's what I've learned. There are times in the midst of it that I can worship him and say, oh yeah, Jesus, and be a follower. And there's also times when I, in the midst of something, and I go, Jesus, you gotta be kidding, and still be a follower. Because he picks us up where we are. And he holds our hand and says, just follow. Because I'm not looking for more applause from you. I'm looking for hearts that say, here am I. I'm ready to follow. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the truth of this word. And I thank you, Father, for the way that you equip us to follow after you. And Father, I pray that you'll work in the midst of this congregation, whether it's to step forward in baptism today, or whether it's to listen to you and respond by forgiving somebody, or by loving somebody, or by serving somebody, or by confessing something that's breaking our relationship with you. Father, we want to listen. We want to respond. We thank you that you are the one who takes us where we are to where you want us to be so we can rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen. As we worship, encourage you, if God's speaking to you and tells you today's the day for you to get baptized, there's the water. Just get up, go to the back, and we'll help you follow him. Let's worship.